Sometimes the most powerful learning experience is the one you wish never happened.
There's one time I was going into Angoon and it was getting pretty low. I was at our minimums of 500 feet and everything, and just looking a little lower up ahead. So I was thinking about turning around and thinking, not too bad. And before I know, too low, this is dumb. No sense keeping on in this. I know it doesn't get any better further on. So I started my turn. And before I knew it, I shot right through my 180 degree heading, went 270 degrees all the way, and I was heading straight for the shoreline. Made it out fine. Didn't ever get super close or anything. But it was a good wake up call of not getting too aggressive when you're down low like that.
It was a very squally, snow showery day. It was December 5th, 1994. Caught in a snow shower, got down low, got myself into a bay, and just ran right into the head of the bay. The wreck is a very painful event. Even if you're not involved in the wreck, it's just the most painful thing there is.
Controlled flight into terrain, which means, long story short, you take a perfectly good airplane and fly it into either rising terrain or terrain in general. CFIT accidents usually result in tragedy. The reason being is the airplane is usually, airplane or helicopter for that matter, is traveling at a cruise speed or at the very least a maneuvering speed. Usually that is not conducive to a survivable type of an accident. Usually it's very traumatic, and unfortunately we see a lot of lives lost in the state of Alaska due to CFIT accidents.
Terrain awareness systems in the airplanes, terrain warning systems in the airplane, moving map displays, all of those things help mitigate a CFIT accident by knowing where you're at, knowing what your escape routes can be, knowing where lower elevation is. Now have just given yourself an additional method to escape from a bad situation.
Really, we see guys that have flown in Alaska for 30 years having CFIT accidents. Recently there has been an influx of CFIT accidents with the seasonal people that come up, and a lot of these have never even seen this equipment before, have very little knowledge of the equipment, and there's been numerous accidents where they found the equipment's actually been turned off because the pilot didn't understand it or didn't know how to use it formally. But, when you bring pilots up and put them in that environment without good training, it's just bad for everybody. It's bad for aviation. It's bad for, the safety environment that we try to operate in.
When I hear that the pilot is new to the environment and he's had an accident, then I wonder how much time he's had out there with other people who are familiar with the environment in training.
If you tried to use the technology for something well beyond what it was, the capability and what it was designed for, that you would basically get yourself in a situation that the equipment couldn't help you in. A great example of this was aircraft would be flying low and they would get lower and lower, and finally the terrain awareness feature, the map, would just go red because they were so low. Being that low caused them to actually exceed the protection envelope that the equipment was trying to provide them. That's why it's so important to be able to understand what the equipment does and how it operates. My recommendation is to get training on the equipment that you have in your aircraft, even if it's a handheld system. If you understand how the equipment works and you understand what protection envelope you can operate in, and you stay in that operational envelope, you're going to be safe.
The simulators are all around the state. They're free. We provide anybody the setup on how to use them, and we'll work with anybody on how to set up their own scenario-based training. You don't have to be a carrier. You don't have to be a member of Medallion. We just want them to use them.
There's a lot of buttons on these moving maps, on this avionics. And once you push a button, All the other buttons do something different. We've got simulators for all this avionics to get you familiar with the button pushing. You're going to be better off by a long shot if all the things you might routinely do out there are automatic for you.
Train, train, check, check, check. I really think that scenario-based training is extremely important. In other words, use the simulators in the classroom, use the training device, the avionics devices, to set it up and fly the routes that you normally fly. If it's a really nice day out, still keep the equipment on and practice with it when it's a nice day, so when it's not such a nice day, you're very familiar with what you should be seeing and what should be going on.
It's direct twos, you can make user waypoints, you can have you can put in a IFR approach to somewhere, you can fly that VFR just to see it, and then you just play with it every day.
You know, I think probably the most important takeaway from this whole subject as far as CFIT accidents is being prepared with a good weather briefing, being prepared with your personal limitations as far as what your skill set is and where that skill set is. And then probably just as important is to have a plan B, have a backup. Know exactly what you're going to do if you do encounter less than stellar weather conditions.
If the equipment shows that you're too low, then you need to turn around and go back. If the equipment shows that you've got rising terrain ahead of you and there's no way that you can escape, turn around and go back. If you are visually seeing these same things, that's a great time to turn around and go back. If you have a situation where you can't turn around and go back, then use the equipment to find a way out. And if that way out happens to be, unfortunately, that you have to climb up through the clouds, you may have to do that.
Your point of turning around should definitely not be when you're feeling uneasy. You should have, you know, clear thoughts about what conditions you're going to turn around in so that you can do that when you're still feeling comfortable and you're not in any danger. If you're noticing that this is happening to you a lot, you need to look at this because that's very dangerous behavior, and you need to pull it back a little bit. There's no doubt.
You know, we've got a job to do, and people are relying on their groceries and whatnot.
It's not worth your lives, though.
Well, yeah, and it's not worth your certificate either, you know. And if you fly at that standard all the time, that's what our passengers expect, that's what dispatchers expect, and that's what I expect out of these guys.
So we put in all this avionics. CFIT accidents are still happening, not as often. What else can we do?
So pilot feedback is critical to be able to make sure that we certify the equipment and understand how it's going to be used and make sure that it's being used properly and understand how we can best get the benefits out of that technology.
At the end of the day, safety is paramount. Know your equipment and honestly assess whether you are using it properly. Utilize the many sources of training that are available and continue training or flying to maintain proficiency, both with the equipment and in your decision making. Don't let fear of FAA enforcement override making safe decisions in an emergency. And finally, keep the lines of communication with the FAA open. Help us help you stay safe.